now it's time for Insight, Boyertown's student-run talk show.
Hello and welcome to October's edition of Insight, Boyertown High School's student-run talk show. I'm Evan, a sophomore here at Bash.
And I'm Joe, also a sophomore.
Halloween is on Sunday this year, and many residents are not sure if trick-or-treating should take place on Saturday instead of Sunday. Some townships have stated that Saturday will be the designated day for trick-or-treating, while others leave it up to the residents. When do you think people should trick-or-treat? Do any of you plan on trick-or-treating this weekend?
No.
No.
I'm not going to go trick-or-treating. I'm probably going to go hang out with my friends over the weekend and dress up, you know, party hard. But I'm not going to go trick-or-treating.
What will you be dressing up as, Kyle?
I don't know. I have no idea.
I will be dressing up as a banana.
Dude, I recognize that costume.
I have a banana costume, and so does Kyle.
We do. Maybe I'll be a banana.
Yep.
Does anyone have any other plans for Halloween?
I was going to say something about the trick-or-treating date. Personally, I think that trick-or-treating not on Halloween is a sin. It should be on Halloween, or otherwise it takes away the importance of the holiday. That's my point.
Agree.
Okay. Does anyone have any other plans for Halloween? Did anyone attend any of the area haunts, such as Pennhurst, Dorney Haunts, or Field of Screams?
No.
I went to Dorney.
I didn't. Good job, Jackson. I haven't
either. I normally
do,
but I didn't this year because I was too busy with things.
I went to Dorney. My friends kept flirting with the actors.
Oh, Sam. Did it all the time.
It was so fun.
I was going to go to Field of Screams this month, but every single day I wanted to go, it kept on raining.
I got chased with a chainsaw at Field of Screams once.
That sounds really fun. That's why I wanted to go.
Until I puked in the bush.
I got put in a cage at Pennhurst once.
I got put in a closet. It's like a metaphor.
They picked me up out of my group. When you go to Pennhurst, you're like in a little group. They took me away from my group and put me in like a jail cell. So I don't know if I will be going back there.
I've been put in a closet, like a divot in the tunnels, and then I almost got put in a locker.
I know me and Kyle have never been to Pennhurst. Like one year we were invited by our friends and we didn't go because we were too scared.
That's true.
You should be. True.
I invited Kyle to Pennhurst this year.
And
he
not
goes,
me?
No, that's too scary.
And
it's
not me?
Because it is, dude. It's scary there. I'll go to the haunt. The haunt is so much cooler.
Okay. Moving on, homecoming was this month, and Boyertown crowned a new king and queen. Leo Egby and Audrey Swarlesley, this year's senior. This year, since our dance was canceled, we crowned the king of homecoming during our virtual pep rally. What do you guys think about the virtual pep rally and the crowning of the homecoming king this year?
I believe that...
Catherine, I got gypped. I didn't say that.
The men were robbed, the princes, I guess you'd say, because I don't know, virtual pep rally, like there's no hype there. Like, it's not like your family could watch you in person. I kind of feel bad for you guys,
upsetting.
But I don't know.
I felt like I would have been excited to walk out on the field with my mom, and then they're like, oh, just kidding. You're in the gym, surrounded by nobody. Like, yeah, so it was kind of awkward, but. Mm-hmm.
I think Nathaniel should have won because he had a funny shirt with his face on it.
I personally think that Kyle and Catherine should have won. That's, but good luck.
I think they should have won. And to whoever the person was who wore a cowboy hat to the homecoming crowning, that was a very brave choice. And I'd just like to admire that fashion choice.
Also, talking about the virtual pep rally, I thought it was very boring because we weren't able to have like an atmosphere and there was so much lag on it and the audio kept on cutting out. The Kahoot was delayed, everything.
I, for one, had fun at the pep rally because I kind of helped do it. I was on one of the cameras, but that just kind of...
Hey, don't get me wrong. I had fun. Me and Catherine were partying hard down there.
Like, I sort of enjoyed it. I was... participating virtually with my class, and the Kahoot again lagged, and like the other events, they weren't as great as they could have been because, you know, COVID, but it was all right for the most part.
Yeah, the issue here is like kids in the classrooms watching are not engaged at all. So who's gonna enjoy just watching people have fun if you're not actually there?
Yeah, I know most kids were like on their phones in my class. And like pep rallies are supposed to be like, you know, there was no pep.
Yeah.
Pep in the rally.
Can I be honest? I just like, I worked and went on my phone. That was it. That's all I did. I wasn't even, I didn't know you were gonna be one of the nominees. I would totally watch for you. That would be awesome. And yes, you seem cool, so I'd watch for you too.
I know.
Okay.
I'm not done.
I am very sorry, Ms. Kevin.
Although it would have been iconic if I won. I love Audrey, yeah. And she's such a nice person, and I'm glad she won. And I also, you know, like the stereotype that like everyone on homecoming court is like fake and only cares about like being popular or whatever. I didn't think that was true this year. Like all of them are so nice and athletic and smart and great. So I would have been happy no matter who won, but I heart Audrey.
Yeah, no, I was totally kidding when I said me and Catherine got gypped. I said it, but I respect every single person. I'm proud of Leo and Audrey.
I don't know who Audrey.
I came sixth on the court. I was so close. So close.
Sixth. Very close.
You almost did it. We're proud of you.
I was so close to being up there.
You're doing great, Sweeney.
My boy, Kyle.
I think we have to... continuing on with the topic of homecoming, did you guys enjoy the homecoming football game? I know I was there. A lot of fun. I personally enjoyed it more than... I don't know. I went to the camo game.
Oh, that was not a good
it
one.
It was so bad.
Yeah. I hated that.
Like... No one was there. It was super empty. It was just all around boring. But the homecoming game.
The camo game was very embarrassing because for you guys that don't know, James Devlin, Boyertown's only ever football player, decided to come to that game out of all the games he could have came to, and we got destroyed.
Personally, I play a very active role in leading the student section, so the camo game really... kind of broke our spirits. Everybody left by the third quarter. So me and my friend were doing a Jingle Bell sing-along because we had nothing good to cheer.
After that game, me and Olivia and Joe, the squad here, we went to Dairy Queen. We each had like a burger and fries.
And I dropped my milkshake.
Yes, and ice cream and everything on the menu. That was better than the football game. I also had to film the football game, but there was nothing to film, and then I couldn't make a highlight reel.
Although I did not attend the football game, I lived close enough to where I could hear it. And I'm not going to lie, you guys, whatever they did out there, they must have been a hell of a game because I could not sleep. So,
it's just like, I went to the camo game. Like, you guys seem like you had adequate experiences. I just got, like, laughed at. But, you know, it's fun because we didn't watch the game at all. We just went, we socialized. I met new people. That was it. That's all that happened. We suck.
Okay, so
anyways.
Moving on. Last month, the district passed a new Spectre policy that all students must present their BASD issued student ID at the ticket gate. Any student in grades 6 to 8 must be accompanied by a paying parent or guardian, and an older sibling who doesn't qualify as a guardian. Do you think this new policy is a good idea?
No.
I think it's a great idea.
It's a great idea.
I mean, yeah, like it's a great idea, but like, I mean, like, you know, No, they literally did not ask anybody to show their ID. They're just like going through. You pay $3.
There's still middle schoolers going through without their ID.
They think we're young or something.
Yeah, I guess it's like, sorry. It's some sort of thing like, if it's not really enforced, is it really a rule? And I get that they're trying to like minimize or prevent the number of incidents that happen, because I've heard that's a reason why they implemented this rule. But it kind of seems like it's not that effective, as in like people still get in without IDs. So yeah, that's just my two cents.
I read the report of why they made the decision. It was because the younger kids were throwing things. But when I was at the game the next week, there was still just as many people throwing things. And if anything, it's more freshmen than the younger kids, because the younger kids aren't in the student section. The freshmen are.
At the last home game, Ticket Spigot crashed, mm-hmm. and then they just let people in without paying.
I had to show my ID to get into that one.
Really?
But they just let me go.
A mustache.
They literally, like, I remember me and my mom, we were suffering in the car. And, you know, there was an 8-year-old behind me in the backseat. And I was like, Mom, we need the tickets. Like, we need these. Like, he needs a ticket to get into. And she's just like, I'm trying. Like, I know. Like, it was like, student picket. What? Ticket.
Ticket Spigot.
Ticket Spigot was like an actual disaster. And then they just, like, when we got there, they just let everybody through. They just said, okay, go. Like, they didn't care.
I don't really care about the ID things or Ticket Spigot. I just think it's funny that kids 8th grade and under have to bring parents with them. Because if I was an 8th grader, I wouldn't really like that. So, that's all.
I mean, if I was a parent, I wouldn't want to take my 8th grader to a football game, because as a parent, you can't go in the student section. And usually the student section is the only entertaining part about our football games. So.
That is true. That's sad.
Okay. California has become the first U.S. state to require large retailers to have gender-neutral toy and childcare aisles. This does not ban girl or boy toy sections, but instead requires retailers to also display toys and other products in a, quote, reasonable way. What do you think of this new law?
Why does it matter? Like, I like, you know, coming from the perspective of somebody who is part of the LGBTQ community, why, like, I get there's a lot of things, you know, gender neutral bathrooms, of course. But, like, why gender neutral? Well, I mean, I guess I can get it, but I don't know. It's just, like, it's a lot of new things. I don't know.
Yeah, I think it's kind of useless, but.
Well,
I don't really care, but they're also, like, babies. So, I don't know. Yeah, I just think that's kind of weird, because they're, like, children that aren't even born yet.
Yeah, I get, like, certain things should be more normalized to, like, gender-neutral type things, but toys, unless it's something, like, glaringly obvious, like, this is for your baby girl, get it for your baby girl, it's all in pink, baby girl, like, it's kind of, like, it's unnecessarily gendered, in my opinion. Like, they're babies, they're toddlers, they don't really understand the aspect of gender yet. They kind of just go along with other people say. So I think that gendering toys, or like not gendering toys, it's just a toy. They're still gonna play with it no matter what.
Like,
so,
I didn't pop out of my mom and be like, okay, here's what I am and here's what I need to do. Like, I didn't know until I was at least in fourth or fifth grade. Like, I didn't, like, that's when I started suspecting. So, I mean, like, it's not like I'm gonna go to the toy section and be like, oh my gosh, like, this toy has pink packaging. Like, I am so offended. Like, I need to, like, I'm swearing. I'm like, I'm going to tweet about this and you're gonna get canceled. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm not gonna do that. Like, it's just a toy.
Yeah. But then I feel like you can kind of make the same argument, because, like, if they're gonna add a third option of, like, gender neutral toys, they might as well just get rid of boy and girl toys. I mean, me personally, when I went to McDonald's as a kid, I would always get the boy toy because they were more fun. So I think, like, by labeling them boy and girl at such a young age, it's already, like, starting, like, harmful stereotypes, and, like, kids feel the need to get a girl toy even if they want a fun boy toy.
I agree. And also, like, gender neutral, I like that idea of making everything gender neutral. I just think it's going to be hard in the stores, because why would you put, like, a doll next to a monster truck? Like, you're not going to just, like, put everything randomly, you know. So I think it's going to be confusing to figure out how, but I think it's a good idea.
I think people complain too much about anything these days. There's always something wrong with anything. People don't like it. I get it. It's your right to complain. You can't. But then, you know, there's also people who don't take things too seriously. Nothing can be fun anymore. Everything's got to be serious. You can't take a joke no more. You can't label toys boy or girl anymore. he can't do anything anymore. I think it's ridiculous in my eyes.
I think that, like, gendering toys or not gendering toys is kind of going to lead to a little bit of confusion, as anything can have a certain gender as long as you think of it a certain way. A doll, like the male version of it, would be like an action figure. And if you gender or not really gender toys, like for kids, it's going to lead to which one is better, which one is worse. And it might lead to a little bit of confusion, like, I want to play with the truck, but the doll is what society wants.
I mean, like, in my personal opinion, it doesn't matter if you gender neutral toys or not. Like, they're still just toys at the end of the day. And they're, like, no matter what gender the kid is or if they identify as a certain gender, they're going to still pick that toy and be like, okay, I want to play with this Barbie. Like, you know, so, and like, you know, piggybacking, yeah, people do take things too seriously, but there are things in the current world that do need to be controlled. However, there are those people who literally will, like, cancel people because they said the word onion or something. Like, you know, there are people who take it too seriously, but are like, you know, like, if they're saying homophobic comments, like, you know, that are genuinely and obviously homophobic, or like racist comments that are genuinely and obviously racist, like, then that, yeah, that needs to be
I understand down. Jokes, but there's a difference between dark humor and like blatantly offensive stuff. So as long as the person who's making the toy or the person who has the toy isn't really saying anything offensive or maybe making jokes that aren't offensive at all, I think that there's no problem in like gendering or not gendering toys.
When I was a kid, I played with Legos.
Dude, same.
When I was a kid, sometimes I would go into my sister's dresses.
Attaboy, Joe.
Okay, okay.
I got the bootlegged Legos once because like my parents couldn't really tell the difference between Legos and Diplo. I was infuriated, so I had to spend months with the same old terrible Diplos. It scarred me.
When I was like a kid, I used to play with My Little Ponies. I'm not kidding, but
Okay, on October 23rd, actor Alec Baldwin discharged a firearm, killing the director of photography for the film he was working on. Wounding its director, Alec Baldwin was told by the assistant director of the film that the firearm was safe before he discharged it. Do you have any opinions on this situation? And do you think Baldwin should be punished?
No. I think it's super sad. It was a sad accident. And whoever gave him the prop gun with like it loaded, that it's their fault.
Whoever said it was safe and then like didn't check if it was genuinely safe, that's their fault. It's not Alex's fault. Like, especially if he, like, especially if there's evidence proven that his statement is true, then that's just a really bad, tragic accident. It's like reminding me of like The Crow, or like the accident on The Crow where there was a blank and it accidentally killed the actor. So
I was reading about this topic, and I found out that there's also 3 other accidental shootings on the set, just no one was injured. So those 3 other ones on top of the one that happened killing someone makes it seem like the whole entire set and crew for the props and the director, the actors, the assistant directors weren't being really careful. So from that, I just think that everyone should be punished a little bit, but I don't think he should directly face all the consequences for accidentally killing someone.
I heard a thing that the prop director or whoever is in charge of making sure the gun doesn't kill someone said that she was like very new to her job and was feeling like uncomfortable like dealing with guns, and then someone died. So
I don't think anybody in particular should be at fault for it. I think it's a testament to how like movie setups are, and that they should be taking care of that better. The one takeaway from this is that the Trump family is now selling merchandise mentioning Alec Baldwin. Guns don't kill people, Alec Baldwin does.
Yeah.
That's disgusting. I'm sorry, I know I'm not going to go into political things, but like that's disgusting nonetheless. Like making fun of a horrible accident that resulted in the death of somebody. It's disgusting nonetheless. Like, you don't make that your merchandise. If you make that your merchandise, you're a horrible person.
You shouldn't make jokes about something that, like something tragic that happened. And let alone something recent that happened. So I think that making merchandise of that is pretty bad, but I don't think anyone's really to blame unless the person in charge of the props is just like, yeah, you can do it, whatever. Because like, when you're working with firearms, you have to really make sure that they're not like, they don't have bullets in them. So yeah, sorry for my voice, but.
I don't think he's coming. I think he's retiring.
I don't think anyone should be like, but like, given the blame. Thank you.
I think he's gonna be retiring after all of that. I don't think he's coming back to filming movies. Like, we're not gonna get a Boss Baby 3. Unfortunate.
Are you serious?
Yeah, dude, he's a Boss Baby. Did you know that?
I didn't know that.
Yeah, like, no more Boss Baby. Unfortunate. But like, all jokes aside, like, it's super tragic, and I feel so bad for him. It's probably gonna be with him for the rest of his life.
The movie that they were working on was Rust. Do you think they'll end up finishing that movie, or do you think they'll never?
No.
I think it's crazy. No, the movie was about like this cowboy helping his brother who was wrong. Yeah, who accidentally killed someone, and that's what happened. Yeah. But also, I heard that, I saw that when he did actually accidentally shoot the gun, he was like practicing like quick draw things and accidentally went off, but.
Sad. Along with what Caleb said, I saw a kid post on Instagram, like repost one of those political meme things, and it was like me, a safe gun owner, being like harassed, but then Alec Baldwin, a not safe gun owner, and I was like, okay.
Those are not.
Let's just give him a break.
Those aren't on the same spectrum. What? Like, that's not the same spectrum. One is like literally you own a gun, okay? The second is. The dude accidentally drew a gun and accidentally shot somebody and killed him. Yeah. Exactly. He's not a bad guy.
Yeah, I think they're going to finish the movie because I've seen like clips of things where they accidentally did, like movies where they accidentally did kill someone. And there was a movie, I forgot which one it was, but they included in like the end credits that, oh yeah, somebody died while filming this, but we kept the shot in because we're dedicated to people like the like watchers entertainment or something. So it honestly depends on how the media like accepts the death.
Yeah. I think it might be delayed, but eventually there you are. Okay. It might be like, you know, delayed, but eventually they're going to come back to it and possibly.
Okay. Sorry, but we, yeah.
Okay. Well, dang.
Every year students in Bash sell Gertrude Hawk chocolates to raise money for various clubs. In past years, one bar has always been only $1. This year, because of higher costs, chocolate bars are being sold for $1.50 or $2. It is also rumored that BCTC will be selling chocolate bars for $2 a piece. What do you think of the higher chocolate prices? Do you think students will pay for the candy regardless of the price?
Listen, have any of you here taken AP economics because supply and demand?
I am outraged. I am outraged either way because as someone that personally has spent $83.50 on chocolate so far this year, for me and my friends, I could have saved a lot of money.
That's ludicrous.
That's just much. I'm really joyful and grateful that many of the chocolate sellers take Venmo. Shout out Luke Gambor, I love you. So yeah, Luke kind of started the Venmo trend, and then a lot of other people started taking Venmo to like compete here. But the issue with Venmo is they started picking up on that the kids were using Venmo to sell a product, and then Venmo started taking a percentage of every purchase away. So then some kids stopped using Venmo, but shout out Luke because he still does.
Wait, Luke still uses Venmo?
Yes. I found, like, for this whole chocolate thing this year, $6. Is that, like, now I use Venmo. I didn't before. I had it before. I just didn't use it before. And that because of my boy Luke Yambor, now I use Venmo. But also, that's when I want to open this up. What's everyone's favorite flavor of the chocolate? Mine's pretzel.
And pretzel.
Mine is also crispy.
Milk chocolate. Milk chocolate is what I don't like. Lava cake.
Everyone calm down.
Oh, it's all fire. Bomb. Bomb. Gertrude's chocolate. Just. She put her entire body into the body, soul, mind into that batch. Like, she is.
Personally, I believe the best.
I'm not. Oh, wait. Oh,
sorry. I believe the best flavor is dark chocolate. Don't at me. Yes. I don't care what? Who yes. says what. Dark chocolate is the best.
Excuse you? Hold on.
Lava cake.
Lava
cake.
You guys. The dark chocolate claim is ludicrous. How can you, like, the most... Yep. Plain flavor in the world. I don't understand that. And pretzel is by far the greatest flavor ever created.
Pretzel lava cake. Hello.
I would like
also
to
lava
say.
Cake.
Also lava cake.
Lava cake.
See, all right, lava like cake is good, but I'm getting something to wash it down after yes. I eat lava cake.
Then get some water.
I'd like to say that. So okay. We can all agree pretzel is the best flavor.
That is true.
It's up there. However, dark chocolate is good, and if you don't like dark chocolate, you just need to grow up. It's like saying you don't like tomatoes.
I don't like dark chocolate,
thank
and
you.
I don't like tomatoes.
Thank you, Cass.
So, like, dark chocolate is good. I will say it is kind of hard to eat that whole bar because it does make you a little parched. It is good.
A little?
But it is good. Like, it's bussin', and, like, just grow up.
I feel like this is a personal attack because as your brother, you know I don't like tomatoes or dark chocolate.
You know, I mean, like, it's. I mean, dark chocolate's not bad. The sugarless dark chocolate that I've had in the past just... Yeah. But, like, dark chocolate, I mean, it's not bad, especially when they do got that sweetener, you know, do got that, make it bussin'. But, you know, I mean, like, it's up there, but it's not my favorite. It's up there, but it's not my favorite.
I would like to speak.
So speak.
Okay,
sorry.
I'm outraged by the chocolate prices, but I will still pay for it because they're really good. But also, I don't like the 50 cents thing because I really don't have change. Yeah.
Then you can only buy two.
So
the I know, but I don't have like $3.
It used to be so easy
like
to
one.
See someone in the hallway and just fling a dollar at them and then take
yeah.
a chocolate.
Yeah, now I have to fling $2 at them, which just
yeah.
drives
them. And then
up
you have to wait for them to get out their little
bag. Not two,
yeah.
three.
And
I have to throw $3 at someone.
And they're trying to make it kind of sound like a deal. Like, you can buy one for $1.50, but you can buy two for $3. But
yeah, like, obviously you can buy two for $3. It's easy math.
Yeah, and as someone who had to sell chocolate before in a previous school for $1, and as someone who ate that entire box, I'm going to have to say that... I'll buy the chocolate, but it depends on the flavor because, yeah.
It's chocolate at school. People are going to buy it. On the subject of flavors, I don't really have a favorite flavor, but white chocolate sucks and it is awful and, yeah, it's not good.
I mean, like, with the whole, like, eating the entire box, like, I'll hear you out on that one. Like, you know, like, that's understandable. I once ate a giant tub of ice cream. Oh, well, then that's not the entire box. I mean, you just shared the entire box, but like...
100%. Yep. I gotta
okay.
agree with this guy.
Wait, Evan, please, really quick.
Yes,
my Catherine. My record of chocolate bars in one day is 11. Go
mine
ahead, Evan.
Is 13.
Well,
that's unhealthy, bestie.
So, next thing. It was announced earlier this month that the senior trip to Florida was canceled for this year. Seniors, were you planning on going on the trip? And do you have it... Do you have to think... it should have been canceled already. Do you think they should plan on a day trip to a local destination in
well,
place of the Florida
well,
trip?
Well, I would like to point out that grammar was astronomical. Thank you. But
I'm devastated.
Dude, I'm so
I am also
upset.
Devastated.
Bro, how could they cancel
it's so
a Disney
stupid.
Trip? Like, I'm a junior, but how could they cancel that?
Yeah, well, it doesn't affect you. It affects us.
I don't care. I still care.
Senior question.
The,
all right, so dude, it was just, I was so upset.
Disney's literally at full
Listen,
capacity right now.
We go on a road trip instead? We get like
yeah.
A,
like,
a group
know,
of people,
I
we go on a road trip?
A lot of other people are just going to Disney now instead. Like not with the school, just
well,
like with their parents.
That's what everybody did last year too.
Uh-huh. But like,
yeah,
it's just, like, it's, it's so.
Isn't there a giant discount though?
No.
It costs more
school.
To go with the school.
Ready? Like $3,000.
Wait, really?
Yeah. Also, yeah. also, if you wanted to get your money back, which was like a thousand some dollars, you had to like put in a request,
what?
Which like
yeah.
the request
Within
period
like
was
a
week long.
Days, yeah.
It was a week
if
long.
If you didn't do that, you lost
yes, you lost
over
$1,000.
Well,
and
that's
it's
not
just,
ridiculous.
It's so not nice.
Controversial opinion. I don't know why you guys are complaining because I don't know a single person that would voluntarily want to go to Disney.
Controversial
that's
opinion.
What is wrong with you, Joe?
Me and Catherine were actually never signed up. We planned on going on our own little fun adventure sometime that week. So we're not too upset by it, you know?
I am.
So
I'm upset by
one
it.
One time, me and Joe went to
One time me and Joe went to Disney with my dad right after my parents got divorced. And guys, this is funny. You guys can laugh. So my dad was trying to like make us feel better. So he took us to Disney, like the happiest place on earth, whatever. And it was like the worst experience of my life. Like we wanted to go home early. We just cried every day. It was just bad. And I literally just don't want to go back. And also there's not enough people in the school that I like to hang out with for 5 days in Disney. So.
Oh, I have a Disney story. I went to Disney for my 5th birthday, and I got the special birthday pin that let me cut the line and all the rides, and we stayed in the Animal Kingdom, so outside my balcony in my hotel was like giraffes and stuff, so it was really, really cool.
I'm glad you had a good
experience. Oh, I have a Disney story. So when I was little, I was scared of like all the characters that were walking around, unless they were Disney princesses, because I was like, I can actually see them. They're not like giant monsters walking around. Except, and then I met Marie, like the cat. You know what I'm talking about? Like the white cat from the Aristocats.
No.
Nobody?
Oh, yes.
Thank you. Marie. Thank you. She had like she got the pink bow. Yes. I met her. Oh. Instantly, all my fears gone. She was sick. That's it.
I think I hugged either, like always hugged the princesses. All I know is I went there when I was 5. Best experience of my life. I'm sorry. Like I still remember some parts of that.
I also have a Disney story. So I went to Disney like when I was a baby, so I don't remember, but like then I went once when I was older, and there's like that ride called Soarin', and it's like where you fly up, and I started hysterically crying on the ride before it even started, and this big man who controlled the ride had to take me out of my seat and out of the ride.
This big man.
No, he was like ginormous. And he picked me up and took me out. And I had to wait outside. It was so embarrassing.
Love the symbols on this.
So 2 weeks ago, we had a half day. During this half day, students had pre-SATs and pre-ACTs. After the half day, seniors had their senior presentations. Sophomore and juniors, how were your tests? And seniors, how did your presentations go?
Guys. All right, so I'm pretty sure almost all of the seniors in this, except for Jake, had
I don't think Gabby did.
No. Oh, and Gabby, I guess. So everyone in the TV News homeroom had their presentations in the same room. Charlotte was in yes, they did. Yes, they did. Luke and anyway, so.
Move on.
We all passed, and I'm sure they heard a lot about telecom that day.
Anyways, I think the PSAT had the most ridiculous questions I've ever read in my life. It was so boring.
They literally looked at me dead in the eyes.
I can't discuss it, but you can't discuss
the questions, but they looked at me dead in the eyes. I said, you don't need a calculator for this test. I was struggling. Like, I was, like, crying. I was, like, stressed out. I was like, what is this? Like, why are we getting stuff we learned back in, like, 8th grade that I don't remember?
Honestly, same. And I only completely finished, like, one section. Yeah.
Well, the PACT was, I'm not going to lie. It was annoying. I can't disclose any of it. I am legally not allowed to. But I'll just say that I called for like higher power 3 times during that entire test. Like it was relatively easy for me, but when there was like a hard question, it was like something I never experienced before. And it just, I've never used that when in doubt, check C rule as much as I did that day. Like I've never used it before, and that was the only time I've used it. It was terrible.
Also taking the pre-ACT, I would just like to point out the questions that they have on these tests were like none of us ever have learned and will never use in our life. So like I don't understand the point of it.
Yeah. I was chilling with the PACT. That test was, I mean, it was long. Don't get me wrong. I finished like one section, but it was easy.
Yeah, I finished like 2 sections, but most of them were, I'm guessing.
The worst part's the reading, because no one wants to sit there and read.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the science.
And we only get 30 minutes to do it, so, yeah.
Yeah, me and the other seniors actually never got to take the PSAT because of COVID. And then we were supposed to take it, and then we had a snow day that day. But I don't think that affected me. Like, when I took the SAT, I did fine without it. I don't really think I needed the PSAT, to be honest. And I also don't know why we take the PACT, because I've never heard of another school actually taking that. Most other schools, sophomore year, take the PSAT. So.
Well, seniors, do you guys enjoy this experience of the senior presentation,
no.
Or do you think it should be replaced with another project?
I would rather do more Smart Futures.
Really?
I didn't think it was that easy.
Now that's a debate. That
it wasn't hard, but it was stupid.
No, I honestly, I mean, I don't want to say I enjoyed it, but like just going, all you did was go up and talk to people. That's all you did.
Leading up to it was terrible, though.
Oh my God,
it was so stressful.
Yeah.
But I had my boy, Mr. Mallison, in there, so I was honestly super pumped.
You were supposed to show up 15 minutes early, and then my presentation was at 12:45, and I showed up at 12:42.
I don't know why everybody made such a big deal about it. They were like, If you fail your presentation, you will not graduate. You'll be poor for the rest of rest of your life. You will not live to see another day. Like it was not that hard. Like you just really had to talk about yourself for 8 to 10 minutes.
I thought
if it wasn't
really
8 to 10 minutes, you got 1 point taken off. Sorry.
I thought it was really easy, and I just kind of like decorated the slides with like pictures of myself. And I think the easier. It's more easy if you're more involved in things in high school, because you really just got to talk about your high school experience and all the things you do. And for me, I try to be involved. Like, I'm in TV news. I'm a cheerleader. So then, like, I put, that's like all that stuff in there.
Yeah, you just kind of talk about, if you just talk about
a
yourself.
I have my TV show. Like, I talked about Tasty, and then they like that.
Yeah, and everyone's so worried about the time. And, like, it's supposed to be within, like, 8 to 10 minutes. Mine was 6 minutes. Yeah, and I only got 1 point off out of, like, what, 36? Yeah. Like, and then also, if you fail it, you can just retake it again. Like, it's not that big of a deal.
Speaking of high school,
thank you,
Jackson. A high school teacher from Riverside, California, has been placed on leave after viral videos of her mocking indigenous culture. The teacher is seen in videos jumping around the room, screeching, "Sokotoa," while wearing a plastic headband and paper cutout feathers to make it look like a headdress. She did this to try to teach her geometry class, Sokotoa. A shortened phrase for teaching a trigonometry function. Do you think the teacher should be punished? And if so, how severely?
Bro, she hit the yoinky slink. Sorry.
That's pretty bad.
Okay.
That is, oh my.
That's
wait, she's a geometry teacher?
Yeah, it's not
she
even.
She was teaching math?
She was teaching math.
Okay, like that, okay, I'm gonna say this right now. You shouldn't be mocking cultures just to simply be like, okay, so here's what Sokotoa is. And like, we're going to discover, like, no, just like teach about it. Don't literally put on a fake headdress and dance around the room. That's. Like, I don't know what was going through her head, but people are going to find that offensive.
In all honesty, I don't know. It's my opinion. I don't think her intent was to mock people. It could be. Who knows? I did think that she was a little, extra with what she did. It was too much going on that I didn't like.
That...
Okay, so when I watch the video, I'm gonna admit it's pretty bad, and I just think that whoever this teacher is, there's probably a low likelihood she'll ever teach again. And
even if
she didn't have a bad intentions in mind when she did it, she needs some diversity training about stuff like that, because it's one thing if you like teach it and like by like making people like cut out like leaves and make a headdress of something that has like Sokotoa on it, but it's another thing when you start screeching and dancing around in an offensive way.
I think
that's where the limit is.
I think she had to have known what she was doing. Who's gonna dance around and scream like that in the first place? Like, I think she had to be mocking them.
I'm gonna say, like, what, like, she looked old, like she looked dusty, like what in her right mind is she gonna like sit, like, I mean, like, I get it, it's the thing, you know, they're like, oh my gosh, no, we're not offending anybody, that was never our intent. That's gonna offend people, like, whether it was your intent or not, that's still going to offend people of, you know, indigenous people are going to be like, let's not do this, please.
Yeah, like, she'd have to know what she's doing. It's one thing to wear the headband. It's another thing for the Sogatoya thing. Yeah. And it's another thing to, like, screech and jump around wearing said headband in an offensive caricature. And how about if someone was Native American there? Like, well, you don't
the
know
the person who
audience.
Took the video was a Native American student who felt like he sat there and watched it happen, and then he got offended and then started taking video. He said that at that point he thought that he had the right to take video, and he did, and then he posted it. So that's where that comes from.
Does anyone else have anything?
I personally, when I took geometry, I was taught Sokotoa to remember all that stuff. And I think that should be the extent of it. I guess if you want to say, like, this is how you could remember it, but I think that should be the farthest you go. Like, you don't need to, like, draw a picture or connect it with any kind of, like, actual, like, indigenous figure. Just, like, say it if you need to remember it in your head, I guess.
Like, the most you could possibly do, which would even be, like, considered offensive to some people, is say, hey, this is Sokotoa. It kind of sounds Native American, I guess. And even then, people would find offense to it. So I think that just saying Sokotoa, and explaining it in a fun manner without including the racial, like, stereotypes that she did would have been fine. And in terms of punishment, she's probably, because that video went so viral, she's probably, even if forgiven, wouldn't go back to being a teacher anymore. But I think she should be punished with medium, like, severity, because it was very racially targeted. So, yeah.
Many virtual currencies such as Bitcoin, Dogecoin, and Binance Coin have been soaring lately. For example, Bitcoin is now going for nearly 63,000, a 20,000 increase from what it was at the beginning of the month alone. Countries like China have banned virtual currency mining, or even have banned virtual currency altogether. Do you think virtual currency is a reliable source of currency, and do you think more countries should move towards using it?
I think it was it Venezuela, Kyle, that used, like, switched their national currency to Bitcoin?
Yes, it was.
Yes, and wait. I'm pretty sure, like, within days, it just, like, sunk their economy.
Well,
like,
Venezuela is not too good to begin with, and that's
yeah. I personally, I don't understand any of the Bitcoin virtual currencies. I know that there's, like, one currency where it's just, like, a PNG picture, and that's what you, and it's, like, a couple thousand dollars, and it makes no sense to me. It's kind of stupid, but
it's crazy.
I don't know.
I don't understand how something that's fake could go for that much.
I'm kind of, what? Why are we talking about this? Like, who decided to put this as a topic? Like,
you're absolutely right. Thank you for that.
Like, we are literally high school students. We're not going to be like, yeah, so, like, here's the thing about Bitcoin. Like, we're not, like, you know, tech geeks like that. We're high school students. I mean, appreciative to whoever is very, you know, interested in the virtual coin.
Yep. Thingy. You know something that we should talk about?
Yes.
The new South Korean Netflix show Squid Game has been taken the world by storm. The series revolves around 456 players in deep financial debt who put their lives at risk to play a series of Korean children's games. Have you watched this series yet? If you have, did you watch it with English subtitles or English dubbed?
This was a crazy show, guys.
I loved it.
Episode 6? Oh,
dude,
Yeah, let's not spoil it.
I did watch the show, yes. And honestly, I think it's a lot better just to watch it with the subtitles, because the English version, like, it doesn't really sound that good. Someone will be dying, and they'll be like, oh no, you're dead.
Like, well, yeah, but, like, it doesn't sound good, but I don't like to read when I'm watching a movie, you know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah,
I feel like,
I mean,
it takes away.
That's the same with me. Like, I can appreciate, you know, like, I don't care, sub or dub. I cannot prefer, like, I cannot have a preference for either one. However, episode 6 made me bawl my eyes out. I sat there and my mom was like, what's wrong? I'm like, episode 6. She's like, got you. Like,
Was that the one where, no, never mind.
It was the marble one.
Yeah, marble.
I cried. I didn't watch it, but I, like, know everything that happens. But I was like, I didn't watch it because I wanted to watch it with subtitles, but then, like, I like watched like a few episodes, but I saw that like I didn't know what was happening because I kept not watching it because like you have to read.
Well, I haven't watched it yet, but when I do, I'll probably watch it with subtitles because I can read and kind of watch at the same time. My brain just kind of picks it up and is like, oh, okay, even though I don't understand this language, this is what it says.
But, I thought it was good. I watched like almost all of it. It was good. It wasn't amazing. It wasn't anything.
Look, I don't know, man. It was pretty good.
Yeah, it was really good.
Wasn't like the next like breakthrough. And
no, it kind of was.
It kind of was.
It wasn't.
Like, it really was.
It was nothing special.
As someone who doesn't.
It literally was something special.
It was special for the sole reason, if you didn't like the series or not, it probably saved Netflix from going bankrupt, which would have shook up the streaming game for sure, which, yeah.
I think if you want to watch it, you just have to get through the first two episodes. That was like the most boring 2 hours of my life.
Yeah, episode two was really bad.
Because I don't really care about that was like the background of all the characters basically, and I don't care. I just want to like see what happens. But that's all I have to say.
Someone who doesn't watch shows often, I feel like that was so worth watching. Yeah. And to people who haven't watched it or haven't finished it, you need to finish it.
Yeah. Objection.
Okay. So the Rita's Water Ice in Boyertown is known for its No Place for Hate memorial. On October 5th, a group of vandals damaged the memorial by covering it with mostly black and white paint. They also included a website address for an organization that is described as a white supremacist group. So far, the community has raised $18,000 for the restoration of the memorial. What are your thoughts on this, and do you feel like it represented the community, and what do you think should be done?
Well, I live relatively close to Rita's Ice like shop. I haven't gone there, and I plan to do so in February because they closed. But I think that they should. I like the idea that they're trying to restore it, and whoever defamed that like model, that like mural, just isn't that great of a person if they're gonna try to turn something that's supposed to be like no place for hate into something like no hate, if you know what I'm saying. Like, you shouldn't try to like defame equality for all.
I don't know, you didn't grow up in Boyertown, right?
Yeah.
But growing up in Boyertown, the No Place of Hate memorial was like something that whenever I went
that
to
was
Rita's
like the
every
icon.
Summer, we would look at it and it would be like, wow, that's a cool painting. It was like a part of my childhood.
Yeah, it's like, so it's, like yeah. Yeah, whenever you came to Boyertown, you would always see the mural and you'd be like, oh my gosh, like look at that. Now, like, I mean, black and white paint, that's pretty bad. But a link to a white supremacist website, what? I mean, like, does this represent the community? I mean, half of it. We're going to be honest. Like, I mean, a lot of the people, I'm not going to be, like, really bad, but, like, a lot of the people in this school, with my experience, are really homophobic. Like, they are very homophobic. And not only that, I've heard a lot of racial slurs while I was here. And, like, people saying, like, racist things. It's, like, honestly, like, it's always, like, the freshmen, but, like, you know, it's always, like, the freshmen who, like, do that. And, like, but, like,
I think it's very sad. And it's a terrible look on the community.
I know. It was a disgusting act. Like, it was really disgusting.
And it's sad because, like, living here, like, every other school, like, thinks of us as, like, a hick school, like, full of, like, racist people and, like, just terrible things happen here. And, like, I've always been like, oh, like, we're not that bad, da da da. But then stuff like this happens and it literally proves their point. Like, we're literally terrible.
Yeah, when I went on the website for Boyertown, because I moved here, like, 3 months ago, and I interacted with some of the locals here, they said that it used to be a really racist place, but I thought otherwise because I said, oh, it's not that bad. But then I see things like the vandalism, and I also happen to live next to someone who I believe is racist because he has like the Confederate flag thing like posted on his car.
I'm gonna say, let me talk. No, I'm kidding. I'm kidding. You're funny. Okay. But yeah, no, like, it used to be a very racist town, and there's still a racist, presence here. Because, like, there used to be KKK marches on the street, like, in the 90s when my stepdad came here. And not only that, the Confederate flag, yeah, a lot of people use it, and they're like, it means rebel. Like, no, that's a symbol from the 1800s that literally represented slavery. Yeah, we're literally the North. Like, what, like, honey?
Also, I just, when people say, like, oh, what school do you go to? It's so embarrassing when you have to say Boyertown, because they're like, oh, so you're like part of the KKK. Like, the amount of people, not all of us.
The amount of people who've been like, oh my gosh, like Boyertown is so trashy. I'd be like, yes, I know. Yeah. Like, I go there. Like, it's so bad. They're like, your school's bad. I'm like, yes, yeah. It's bad.
And I don't want people to just like think I'm racist because I go to Boyertown. Like, it's just like, yeah. So
see, people just vibe with me because they know I'm gay.
I think, like Chris said, 50% is good. The other 50% isn't so good. And if you find good people in Boyertown, it really isn't that bad. Like, I could say I know most of the people on this panel, all of them are pretty nice, good people. So,
I mean, when I first met Gabby last year, I was like, oh, she looks like she'd be homophobic. Like, she looks like she'd call me a slur.
But even, I am offended.
But then as I got to know her, like, I was like, oh my God, she's genuinely like this sweet, caring person with great hair. I'm not even gonna lie. But you know, but a lot of the people here, like, they're like really homophobic and like disgusting about like anything that's diverse, any type of thing that's diverse. They're like, oh my gosh, no, I'm not homophobic. Then they literally go off and call people slurs.
Very true. With Halloween coming up, there are many old horror movie classics reappearing on streaming services. You can now watch movies like Scream, Halloween, Friday the 13th, and many more on a variety of streaming platforms. There are also a slate of new movies coming out, such as The Conjuring 3, Spiral, The Forever Purge, and the Fear Street series. Also, Halloween Kills, the latest in the Michael Myers series, was released last month. Have you had a chance to watch any horror movies this month? If so, did you enjoy them?
My favorite movies are horror movies. Me like too. I love Fear Street. It was so good. And the fifth Scream that's coming out in January, I'm so excited because the guy from the first movie, he's like alive. So I want to see how that plays out.
Spoiler.
It's not a spoiler.
I heard my friends, I didn't see it, but my friends went to see the new Halloween movie, and they all said it was really bad.
That's what my dad said.
Yeah, because like Michael Myers isn't he just like a regular person? Like, he's not like a demon, but he got like beat up and like jumped and like all these different things, and he still lived. So like, it's kind of a plot hole.
I mean, he walked out of a burning house like it was
nothing. No, 100%. Listen, I saw that movie. I thought it was great. People who are saying it bad, everybody's like, it didn't go nowhere. It went nowhere. You got to expect that. They did so well in the first one. You think they're not going to milk this? They're milking
it.
An
entire series that made literal millions, like Friday
they're
the
13th. They're milking
this. Like, Friday the 13th at least had something behind it where he became like immortal, like Jason became like immortal. But like, then Halloween, like, love it. Love the series. 2018 was, oh my God, it was great. I loved Halloween 2018. But I mean, it's just like, they're gonna milk it, so you can't really expect it to go.
I watched The Shining, and that's so scary. I was that so was like scared.
That was like a trippy
movie.
You know,
I was tripped out, and it was really good, though. But also, another scary movie is Insidious.
Oh, yeah, that's so a good. Very
so
good.
Scared.
Insidious.
The third one, it's so good.
Yeah, and when
she's like trying to summon her mom, and then like it's
like that scary man.
Okay, so anyways. I personally love horror movies too, and if you didn't watch Fear Street, watch it now because
it's great. Great. It's great.
Okay,
72.
So unpopular opinion: men should always pay on the first date.
Yes. Wrong.
Well, I think so.
Well, my opinion is that
I believe.
I don't really agree with that opinion. It honestly just depends. Like, sometimes it's who instigates the date, but
I always offer to pay, but like, I'm very broke. So I think it's really nice if they pay.
100%. Whoever like asks someone out on a date, if you're a girl and you ask a guy on a date and you take him, you should pay. Yeah. If a guy asks you out, he
that's
should pay.
True.
It's whoever wants to go on the date.
I think you should do like a little back, like, you know, back and forth. So like, they pay for
100%.
Dinner.
I like that.
You pay tip. You know, you go to a movie, they pay the movie.
Back and forth is easily the best method.
Exactly. You just go back and forth.
It works the best.
You know, I never like know how to feel about these kind of topics because like I'm all for like the gender neutral things and such, but also like guy has to be like a gentleman, you know, and like hold the door open for you. And but what if like you're not in a straight relationship? Then what?
Ooh, I can do this. I can deal with this. Whoever's the more masculine one pays then, if that's okay. I mean, I'm sorry, that's weird to say, but that's true. I mean, like, you know, whoever's the more of the man in the relationship, whoever wears the pants in the relationship, not the skirt, then they are the one who usually is expected to pay. But to be honest, like, if you're asking them out on a date, whoever, like Dan said, like, whoever asks the other person out on the date should pay or be expected to pay.
Joe. Okay. I think that's true. And then whoever like pays for the first date, the other one pays for the second date. If they're the second date.
Just go back and forth. The back and forth method.
I think that while like some people argue that it's a men you and that men should pay, men you could also be like me and you. So I think you should be prepared to pay if the date doesn't go well. Like you should pay for your own dish. But I think it's whoever instigates the date first. I think they should pay.
I think everyone should at least offer to pay just to be polite. But yeah. I think once you start doing things every once in a while more often together, you should just go back and forth because then there's no argument about it.
Yeah.
But on a first date, I think everyone should just be polite and either offer to split it or someone just take the whole thing.
I agree with that.
Yeah, split it between everybody there.
I don't think anyone should expect not to pay.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
But I feel
as
like,
far as paying for the whole thing or just splitting it?
On the first date, I feel like they should offer, but the guy should always pay on the first date.
Yeah,
like, it just feels right, I guess.
I don't like when I'm like, not to call anyone out, but when my boyfriend is like, I'll pay, and then I'm like, no, it's okay, I can pay, and I expect him to be like, no, I insist, but he's like, okay, and then I just end up paying every time.
Yeah, that's what I mean. Like, the first date, it's kind of like the guy's job, I guess.
Yeah.
It does show that you are more of a gentleman.
I don't have any experience in not paying people back.
Oof.
Right, Catherine?
I bought tickets for me, Kyle, Jackson, and Isaac for a Tyler, the Creator concert in coming up March 6th. Jackson here waited 2.5 months to pay me back.
You're done.
The $103.
You're done.
He owed me
You're done.
$85 for concert tickets. And I also You're am done, a Jackson. Small business owner, and he didn't pay back the small business.
Jackson hates small businesses.
You're done, Jackson. You're done. Day. You're canceled. Canceled. Twitter. Give me the phone. Give me the phone. You're done.
Everyone, I paid her back like 2 weeks ago. It's fine.
Literally a week ago, not even.
A week ago, Thursday.
With Venmo, like, how dare Luke Yambler?
How dare you suck that hope out of her? Like she's gonna get her cash back.
The fact that you took that long to pay, because I know that
that's just
we
wrong.
Were on vacation in the middle of a tour when my sister paid for those tickets. So she had to go out of her way just to buy your tickets. So the fact that you took that long to pay.
Look at you standing up for your sister.
I just want to say, Catherine, I appreciate you for buying me those tickets.
Catherine, I just wanted to say, of the entire panel, you're my favorite.
Well, can I speak? Yeah. Well, then again, you shouldn't really take my advice in like when it comes to relationships because I've never been in one, so thanks.
Okay, thank you for joining us on October's episode of Insight. We will see you next month.
Lab began to rise, and suddenly, to my surprise, he did the monster mash.
The monster mash.
It was a graveyard smash.
He did the mash.
It caught on in a flash.
He did the mash.
He did the monster mash.